Welcome back to Suhan Unfiltered at suhanunfiltered.com. I am Jim Suhan. I am the host of this podcast. Michael Russo is my guest today. Michael and I will be doing a joint podcast soon, and he'll have his own page and your own way to access his stuff. But for right now, you can find this podcast, all the other podcasts, at suhanunfiltered.com. We appreciate you listening. We're going to get into a lot of stuff. I'm going to let Michael Russo rip Thomas Vanek later. I might let him rip everybody in the entire locker room. We'll see just how vicious he wants to get. But let's start off.
First of all, I got to apologize that it's been so hard to nail me down to do one of these. I've been running around the country with the Wild.
Last time
we were going to do it, I thought I was having a heart attack.
I know. It's like you bring me notes from your doctor to get out of doing podcasts.
that one was serious.
How are you feeling, by the way?
I'm feeling great, but I landed from Chicago last week, and we were supposed to do a podcast because it was going to be my one day in town. It was the day they're playing the Boston Bruins. But I thought I was having a freaking heart attack on the plane because I had a thing. Did I tell you about what happened to me in Phoenix where I wound up on the trainer's table in the Arizona Coyotes locker room?
Okay, that's where we're going to start, and that's a good tease. Let me round out the introduction, then we'll get right to you. Michael Russo, Star Tribune hockey writer. You know who he is, but I just have to say that. Also, Suhan Unfiltered, we do it live 5 o'clock on Wednesdays. This week was an exception, but from now on, 5 o'clock Wednesdays, either the local or Kieran's. We alternate sites this Wednesday, New Year's Eve, 5 o'clock at the local. Haven't lined up my guest yet, but I'll have somebody really either cool or intelligent or both. At that, you can find our network of podcasts at Alive and Social. Go check it out on Twitter, at Alive and Social. And, okay, now tell me about laying on the trainer's table in Phoenix.
Yeah, it was bizarre, during overtime of that game. And trust me, it wasn't because I was stressed. I've covered much more stressful situations. Like I was just telling my shadow here, Ryan Yock, about the Nino Niederreiter game. That was stressful. This was not. This was just a normal regular season.
I wrote the worst column I've ever written deadline.
I barely didn't even write my final story that night.
It is amazing. I mean, especially, God, newspapers are so old school. Here you are, you're out west covering a game that millions of people care about, and it's going to be the most read thing in your paper the next day, and you have 3 minutes to write it, and you don't have time to edit yourself, and you send in a piece of crap, and you feel embarrassed for 48 hours.
Yeah, I was emailing quotes, and it was bad. So all of a sudden, it was just crazy. My heart was just, beating through my chest, really fast.
More so than usual.
Yeah, more so than usual. I mean, even to the point that, my colleague from the Pioneer Press, Chad Graff, I'm like, do me a favor, just feel my chest for a second. He had an absolute heart attack. He could not even believe what.
Metaphorical.
He could not believe it. And so that made me even more nervous when I obviously knew this was not a normal situation. But when he, had that reaction, I'm like, all right, this isn't good. So I covered the rest of the game, but I was emailing with Kevin Bertels, our slot guy, hey, just to let you know, I'm going to file up the story, but there's a chance I'm going right to the hospital. And so he told me not to worry, all this stuff. So I go to the elevator after the game. That was the game that Koivu won it in the shootout. I go to the elevator after the game, and I was obviously very concerned. And Tom Reed looks at me, and he goes, oh, what are you, having a heart attack? And I'm like, I think I might be. And he put his hand on my chest, and he's like, holy shit. So I could curse, right?
Go right ahead.
All right. So
it was funny. Mark Craig did my first podcast. Uh-huh. And he cussed up a storm, and it was hilarious. Last night, he was my first repeat guest. I had him on again, and his mother's in town, and his mother's going to be listening. Not a single curse word. But you go ahead.
All right.
You're from New York.
Well,
you can drop them.
The next one's actually funny, the next curse that's going to come out of my mouth. So I go down to the locker room, and I go, and, Carly Peters, who's the Wild PR person that trip, she's there. She's kind of asking, who do you need? And, I'm like, well, Parisi like this. But, she goes, who do you need? I go, Don Fuller. And she looks at me like, what? And Don Fuller's the medical trainer for the Wild. And I'm like, honestly, feel my chest. And she runs and gets Don Fuller. Okay. So Fuller, this is right after a game when Fuller's got to be pretty busy with a bunch of hockey players. Right. He comes out. This is where I got really nervous. So he's telling him that I think something's going on here. So he just grabs my hand to take my pulse, and he immediately brings me down to the Arizona locker room. So now it's me, two doctors in their room, and on the next table is Kyle Chipchura, who plays for the Coyotes. So now the sports writer in a suit right after a win is on a trainer's table in the Coyotes locker room. And so they're asking me, do you feel sick? I'm like, no. Do you have chest pain? No. Do you have pain down your arm? No. Do you have swelling in your legs? I'm like, not more than normal. I'm a little overweight, but not more. So then he goes to me, have you had a lot of caffeine today? And I go, or he goes, have you had an excessive, or how did he go? He goes, have you had a lot of coffee today? And I just go, a shitload. And then he just like smiles and he goes, I think you overdid it with the coffee.
You do it overdid with coffee every day. In fact, we need to get a coffee company to sponsor this podcast.
Here's where I thought that I was being brilliant. Okay, so we're staying at the Renaissance there in Glendale. And they have a, like, you know, we proudly serve, you know, a Starbucks in the lobby. And I thought I was doing the Star Tribune favor here. Instead of buying me 8 coffees that day, if you keep your cup at this hotel, you could refill as often as you want. So I probably had about 8. So
I think that was a plot to kill you.
Yeah. So the doctor basically tells me, you know, weed yourself off coffee for a couple of days. So I run now back to the locker room to get Parisi and Mike Yo. And so, actually, it's funny. I run upstairs. I tell Kevin, hey, I think I'm fine. I'm going to write my story. So I wrote my next story. And then I wrote just the worst blog ever. And I even at the end said, hey, I barely was in the locker room today. I had a little medical incident on my blog. But anyway, so then I kind of didn't drink coffee the next couple days and felt great. But then all of a sudden, we're flying back from Chicago that morning after the next day after the game. And I'm only in town for like 14 hours because I got to cover the Bruins game. And then I was leaving town that weekend. And all of a sudden, for the first time, I actually was having chest pains. And so I emailed a doctor on the plane and he said, come right in. I did like chest x-rays and EKG and it was, boy, this is really therapeutic.
Is it? You feeling better?
Yeah, I am feeling better.
I'm not. You're making me sick.
Just tell all these strangers.
You're giving me chest pains.
So he tells me everything is fine, but he's like, you know, I just want to be careful. And so they put me right into Minnesota Heart, and I saw Dr. Thiessen, and who's got the best bedside manner of any doctor I've ever had in my life. Like, she makes me feel so comfortable. I go in there, and she's a huge Wild fan, by the way, just like sits right behind the bench. From Vancouver.
So you two got a thing going now?
Nicest,
dinner Saturday, anything like that?
Nicest woman in history. And she's just like explaining everything to me. And I did a stress arco right there. And my heart was completely healthy. And she's like, don't drink a lot of coffee. So I'm only on 3 today. I have calmed down with the coffee. All right, so what do you want to talk about?
Well, let's start with the most important thing here. Will you really stop drinking coffee?
No, I can't stop drinking coffee.
But what will you cut down? You cut down from what, 12 cups to 8?
No, I have. I've started to be, I've been better.
I don't believe you. Tell me about your exchange. You know, you hit me right before we started the show with, like, I had all these hockey questions, stupid hockey questions lined up for you. And you start talking about Anthony Weiner and spilling coffee on the Panthers owner's floor.
Yeah.
Take it, man. Tell me the Anthony Weiner story.
Yeah, that was bizarre. A lot of people saw that. That was a couple weird days. So we're in San Jose. So the Wild play the Islanders at home. And that was the game that that Matt Martin defigured Keith Ballard.
Yes.
I think you were here for that, right?
Yes, I was. Yeah.
And so I can't remember exactly how this came up, but, you know, I was being a little critical of Matt Martin on my blog.
Which is fair.
Yeah. I just said that it was a reckless hit and, you know, maybe not suspendable, but blah, 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 blah. And all of a sudden I'm leaving practice the next day in San Jose, and I'm getting just annihilated all morning by Islander fans. And all of a sudden I look and one of the tweets that I got is from Anthony Weiner. So I'm like, oh, I wonder if it's the Anthony Weiner. And then I look and it's verified.
And for background, you're a New York boy too.
Yeah, I am a New York Long Island guy. And it's Anthony Weiner, the Anthony Weiner, the disgraced.
Did he send any pictures?
Well, here's the funny thing. So now all of a sudden I just write him back on Twitter like, wow, I can't believe this is really you. Cool or something like that. Like, they cool that you're an Islander fan, because I grew up an Islander fan. This is, again, the disgraced congressman that sent naked pictures of himself.
Well, not naked.
Yeah. Flexing in his underwear pictures.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, that's more accurate.
So I'm talking to him back and forth. He's like, you know, how'd you wind up in Minnesota? I'm telling him how I wind up in Minnesota. Oh, next thing I look, you know, I'm just thinking I'm having a conversation with the congressman, forgetting that everybody follows him, right? And now all of a sudden I'm looking at my mentions, and now everybody's talking about the fact that I'm having a conversation with Anthony Weiner, like the most random thing that you could see on Twitter, the hockey writer in Minnesota and the disgraced congressman. So then I'm driving back to the hotel, and I look, and I get an advisory, because, you know, when somebody that's verified follows you, you get an advisory in your phone. All of a sudden, Anthony Weiner follows you. So I went through this unbelievable debate all day. Do I follow him back? Because I was worried about that he would send me pictures, right? Because, you know, that's how you get in touch, you know, that's how he got
in. And the really big question here is his penis verified?
Right. So I did not check. But so finally, after a lot of deliberation, I followed him back. And so now it's like I'm talking to Anthony Weiner about hockey and
direct you end
messages.
Up with the weirdest group of friends and associates. You know, we mentioned on the last podcast we did together, you're kind of buddies with Adam Duritz of Counting Crows too.
Yeah, I mean, I you know, I actually haven't talked to him a long time. I wouldn't say that we're buddies, but we have a very one of his best friends is one of my best friends. That's essentially how it comes. So what happened was one of his buddies, this guy Roxy Bernstein, who is the he's the play-by-play guy on ESPN for a lot of football games, and he's a Cal Berkeley play-by-play guy. He used to be so during the lockout in 2004-05, I covered the Marlins, and he was the play-by-play guy for radio for the Marlins. So one day we're going to Atlantic City, like all sports writers do when you're covering a Philly series.
Absolutely.
So we're going to Atlantic City, and he's telling me that he's buddies with Adam Duritz, and I'm like, I'm a huge Counting Crows fan. And next thing I know, Adam Duritz calls him, and now for the entire ride, we're basically talking on speaker with Adam Duritz the entire ride. And then from that point on, every time that there was a concert or anything like that, you know, I would go and hang out with those guys and go backstage, and I've seen some funny, funny stuff hanging out backstage with the Counting Crows. You know, nothing that I should probably say publicly. I mean, there's some great stories that if I think about, I mean, just cool stuff hanging out on his bus or hanging out in bars. Like, here's one for you. And like, we're backstage at coincidentally another trip at the Borgata, and he's got a bunch of people backstage, and Duritz is just a great guy, huge sports fan, and I think it was another Marlins trip, and he brought a bunch of Marlins people back there. So we were back there with like Kevin Gregg, the reliever, Tankersley, who's the guy from Holland that plays I don't know if he's still there, a pitcher, Vanderkook or Vander or something. I don't
know. Borgenbergen.
Yeah, something like that. He was there, bunch of Marlins. And so we're backstage, and so we're hanging out with all these just kind of groupies back there, and this woman comes up to Adam Duritz after the show. We're not in his green room, but we're in kind of like a little party room. And she goes, you know, I can't even tell you, I'm a teacher in New Jersey. I think your lyrics are just absolutely incredible. You know, your words, I teach it to my students. Like, I just cannot tell you how much I love you. And he's like, oh, thank you very much, you know, blah, 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 blah. And there's this guy next to the woman. And the guy's just standing there, and Duritz kind of looks at him like, you know, do you want me to shake your hand or what? And the guy goes, hi, I'm her husband. And I actually can't stand you, but she plays you so much that I'm starting to tolerate you. And Duritz looks at him and goes, I don't even know what to say to that. So now we walk away, and we're going back to his green room because he. What happened was Duritz, back in those days, Counting Crows had like these baseball jerseys at Counting Crows. Mm-hmm. So the Marlins brought these jerseys to give to Duritz, and Duritz was giving them, and they were going to exchange them and sign them. So all of a sudden, I'm following Duritz back into the green room, and I walk into the green room, and there's a mirror facing us, and I realize suddenly that my friend Roxy and none of the Marlins are with me, and it's just me and Duritz in his green room. And this is immediately after this incident. And I could tell that he was a little rattled by this. And all of a sudden, he turns around and just basically has a rant about who the hell. It's like, who the hell are these people? How do they get back here? And that was just me alone in the back with Adam. I'm like, hello, where's my friends? You know, like, can you come here and help me? So that was pretty cool. But he is one of the coolest Counting Crows experience. They were here playing the Basilica Block Party once. So before the show, I went backstage. And there were people that, you know, like if you're in their fan club, you can, you know, come back during the show and things like that. And so soundstage guy, but another guy basically is like, hey, when you hear this song, come backstage. And then when they play Hanging Around, you're all going to come on stage and dance on stage. So it's me and Ashley. She works for the Wild now. Her name's Jora Bart. She went to the show with me. So we go backstage, and I'm with her, and then all of a sudden the beginning of Hanging Around comes, and she just flies on stage and leaves me. So now I kind of tiptoe on stage, and now I'm backstage on stage with the Counting Crows as he's playing Hanging Around, and everybody is dancing like crazy. And I'm not a rock star. You know, I don't like to dance at weddings. I don't dance, man.
You should have just done like the Charlie Brown dance.
So now I am in the middle of a Counting Crows concert on stage, standing still, while everybody is dancing, okay? And so I decide now to pull out my BlackBerry. I actually have pictures on my Facebook. I pull out my BlackBerry to start just taking pictures. And I see Duritz look at me a couple times. You can tell he's like, what the hell are you doing? Like, if you're going to be on stage, you got to dance. Like, you're standing in the middle of my song here. And finally, and it's, I mean, this worked out perfectly because it's on YouTube. All of a sudden, I don't know, somebody from the stands was filming this, and he turns around and he calls me out in the middle of the song, in the middle of a lyric. He goes, "Is that the best you could do, Russo?" And that, so all of a sudden, after the show, I'm telling my brother this story, and he can't believe it. And the next day, I get this YouTube link from my brother. He goes, "You're not going to believe it. It's on YouTube."
Oh, good Lord!
Because somebody was filming, you know, hanging around, and put it on YouTube, and that was called out in the show. So. Put that on my Facebook too.
It's funny. A couple of weeks ago, I had Gary Louris of the Jayhawks on for a podcast.
Yeah.
And he was saying he and the other Jayhawks sang on the Counting Crows most successful album.
Yep.
Kind of cool connection.
Actually, that was cool. At that Basilica block party, the Jayhawks were playing the other stage by the actual Basilica. So I went on the golf cart with Adam Duritz to the Jayhawks show, and it was really neat to sit back there and kind of watch Adam Duritz, you know, just appreciate somebody else. You know, it was pretty neat.
Yeah,
you know,
that
because,
is cool.
Because, you know, I do think Adam Duritz is absolutely brilliant. Like, I mean, you just watch him perform. The guy is unbelievable. And so, like, just to watch, you know, and I've gotten to, you know, be friends with a couple other musicians like Eric Hutchinson and Matt Hires. And to see them, like, I was backstage with Eric Hutchinson when they played the Basilica here this summer. And Michael Franti and Spearheads were playing back there. And it was just cool listening to them talk to each other and appreciating each other. It was pretty neat.
I was just in Miami for a Vikings game and ran in and hooked up with the Dolphins' longtime PR guy. I think he's like a historian.
Harvey Green.
He's like a historian now, Harvey Green. And, you know, obviously you know Harvey from working in that market. Tell me about your time in Florida covering the Panthers and what you did to the Panthers owner's floor.
Well, you know, I was lucky. My first year, I was 21 years old covering the Panthers. I was like backup to the backup. I was 95, 96. And actually, I mentioned my shadow here, Ryan Yock. He was just looking at the credential list back there, and Scott Mellenby is listed there.
Mm-hmm.
And Scott Mellenby wasn't the captain of that team, Brian Skrulowicz, but he eventually became the captain. But he was the leading scorer of that Panthers team. And the great year of that year was the year of the rat. And the way the year of the rat started, if anybody remembers, is after every Panthers goal, people would throw plastic rats on the ice. And the reason why that started is early in the season, the Panthers are playing the Calgary Flames, and Mellenby, we're in the old decrepit Miami Arena, and a rat runs across the locker room floor, and he takes a slap shot of the rat, puts it one times it right into the wall, kills it. So after then that game, Mellenby scores two goals in a 3-1 win. And we're interviewing John Van Beesbrouck after the game, and he calls it a rat trick. And so that became this, you know, like a normal, just, you know, innocuous game story. Rat trick. You know, he scored a rat trick. Panthers catch fire, go to the Stanley Cup Finals. Slowly but surely during the year, like one plastic rat's thrown on the ice. Two pass after every goal, and then in the playoffs, just go to YouTube. Thousands of plastic rats. The Panthers actually had to hire, like, Orkin people, like, you know, or what they did is they struck a endorsement with Orkin, and they put Orkin shirts on all these, you know, arena workers. And then after every goal, they'd run on the ice and Orkin things and pick up these plastic rats. It was unbelievable that year. They go to the Stanley Cup Finals. There are people, they weren't scalping tickets on the street. They were scalping rats. You'd walk into my arena, and you'd have to, you know, they'd be selling plastic rats for $10-$15. You go to, like, Eckerd or Walgreens before the game and try to buy plastic rats. They were sold out of shelves in South Florida. And so Mellenby is the one that started that. So I'll look forward to introducing Ryan here to Mellenby later today. He's scouting for the Montreal Canadiens now. That was the Diet Coke story is freaking hysterical. So the Panthers owner at that time, Alan Cohen, great guy, was a generic drug guy. That's where he made all his money. Now is into horses and things like that. The Panthers had training camp in Vail, Colorado, for a couple years in a row, I believe. And the reason why is because Alan had a second home right next to Kelsey Grammer's home in Beaver Creek. So one day during training camp one year, Alan taps me on the shoulder at practice and says, "Hey, you know, I want to invite you and the other beat writers over to my house tonight for a dinner party." And I'm like, "Oh, that'd be awesome." So, I think this was right around the time that I pretty much quit drinking. I didn't drink for a while. And so we get to his house, and I'm in his house, and I'm a little nervous. You know, I barely know Alan Cohen. We're going to a mansion, the owner's house, you know, I'm some lowly, you know, classless sports writer, right? You know, like I shouldn't be hanging out in a nice place like this.
None of us should ever be allowed any place
exactly.
nice.
Exactly.
In fact, the X is way too nice for us.
So I knock on the door, and his entire family comes to the door to greet us, including, like, you know, a housekeeper. And she goes, can I get you guys something to drink? And I just go, can I get a Diet Coke?
And living large.
Yeah, I am. She comes over with a can, like a just a really wet can of Diet Coke, and she puts it in my hand. And I'm in his house for 2 minutes, slips right out of my hand and just splatters all over the front entryway of his house. And it was just Chuck Fletcher was there that day, the Wild GM. He was the Panthers assistant GM at that time, and he reminds me of that story all the time of me being mortified in the front entrance 2 minutes after being Alan Cohen's house of spilling a Diet Coke all over his carpet. It was just brutal.
Can't take you anywhere.
Yeah, that was definitely one of the most embarrassing. You know that feeling when you're just totally embarrassed and you just, like, sweat through your, like, you know, everything? Like, you just start, like,
I've done that.
You're overheating and you're mm-hmm. sweating. That was that. Like, I could not, if I could have jumped off that mountain, I would have done it at that very moment. I was very, very, anyway.
That's Michael Russo embarrassing himself. This is Suhan Unfiltered.com. You can listen to our podcast live or anytime later. That's the cool thing about them. Let's get to a little bit of hockey talk, and then we'll come back and do Michael Russo Explores America some more. You had a good piece in the Strip today, talking to Fletcher about this team's struggles. The Wild, we're up in the XL Energy press box. The Wild's going to play Winnipeg tonight. They're playing horribly. They played great early. They've been playing horribly lately. They're not getting good goaltending. Vanek's problem, but nobody else is playing well either. Sometimes there's not a correct answer to why a team is struggling. Do you have a clue, or is this just a general malaise?
I think it's a general malaise. I think there's a thousand things that have gone into it. And the one is going to sound like an excuse. It'll probably get me a preposterous statement award. But, you know, this mumps and illness thing has really affected this team.
I agree with you.
If you watch them, they are not a healthy team right now.
No.
They have no energy. They have no excitement. Just because we report that a Jason Zucker is sick or a Mikhail Granlund is sick or a Darcy Kemper or Nicklas Backstrom doesn't mean that they're the only guys sick. All these guys have been affected by illness now for a month and a half. I'm not just saying that to make an excuse for them. And again, who cares? They've got to overcome it. But I'm telling you that, you know, just because Ryan Suter's back with the mumps doesn't mean he's healthy. You know, there's a reason why he's -9 in his last, like, 10 games with getting 9 or 10 points in that stretch. You know, that's an impossible thing for Ryan Suter to do, is to get all these points and yet still somehow be a -9 or whatever it is. Again, there have been other players that have gotten sick that have somehow, at the time that they got sick, still allowed them to play in games. So, you know, this team's been sick, and again, I'm telling you this because, you know, I've been sick for a month and a half. I mean, it is like you walk in there, and it's just a cesspool of filth. Now, onward.
Still reminds me of the time, reminds me of the day I walked up to Parisi and in the locker room, and I started talking to him, and he looked at me and said, have you had your booster shot yet? I said, no. He said, you shouldn't be in here.
Yeah. No, I know. I mean, I just can't believe that I haven't gotten this stomach thing yet. I mean, this is a norovirus going on this team. I mean, I'm using that term, and people think I'm joking. Just read the Star Tribune 3 days ago. The norovirus is in Minnesota. It's affecting everywhere. How many people have you heard? There's this kid that follows me on Twitter named Wyatt that told me that he just had some crazy flu. I just talked to a woman yesterday that had some crazy. It's like there's this crazy stomach bug that's going throughout Minnesota right now. And of course, if it's in Minnesota, it's got to tiptoe its way into the Wild locker room. And these guys are like, I mean, I told, probably not you, but Darcy Kemper in Chicago that morning was starting against the Blackhawks. He's on the floor of that locker room doing stretches, just shooting the breeze with me and Scandella, talking to us about how much weight he's lost during games at times. And he's like all bubbly and he's starting that night. And then all of a sudden we get to the game and Nicklas Backstrom leads him out. And then I see Kemper, 6 hours after I was talking to him, after the game, that he looked like he was hit by a bus. Mm-hmm. This thing comes out of nowhere. Apparently on the team playing that night, they had to put, like, masks on him. They had to, like, cover him in blankets. I mean, this is ridiculous. And it's affected Granlund. It's affected Coyle. It's now Zucker tonight. It's got both goalies. I mean, and again, like I said, other guys on the team. So, again, but that's not why they stink right now. They stink for many reasons. They've gotten bad goaltending. I think it started with bad goaltending. Then all of a sudden when you're, you know, it's just natural. When you don't have a lot of confidence in your goalies, then all of a sudden you start cheating and doing stupid stuff defensively. And this team has just done a lot of uncharacteristic stuff. When have you seen guys like Suter and Brodin do some of the stuff they were doing last game? Mikko Koivu, one of the worst games he's played in a month and a half, and he's been good lately, throwing pucks away left and right the other night. You know, that Philly game was as bad as it's been. So I just think that right now they've lost their way. They've gotten a lot of bad habits. The details of their games, the middle lane drives that made this team so good, the having the puck and being flawless coming out of the breakout, all that stuff has disappeared. I don't even remember what this team looked like when they were good. And so, you know, right now they've got to figure out a way to get it back. There's no better time than these two games, because if they lose these two games in regulation, I don't want to say the season's over, but now you're looking 12 points behind one of the two teams that you really conceivably, theoretically can catch. I mean, you know, we could say that the Wild could chase all they want, but in my opinion, if you look at the top eight, there's only two teams that have a chance of coming out, and that's Winnipeg, and I don't mean that with any disrespect to Winnipeg, because they are playing great, and maybe they are for real, but we still have not seen it yet to believe it. So to me, you know that the LA Kings are in eighth place, are going to figure it out. They're going to, right? They're not catching the LA Kings.
Right.
So you have Winnipeg, who's seventh, and then you have Vancouver, who I still also need to see to believe. I don't even understand how they're even in the sixth spot. So if LA figures it out, they'll take that third spot in the Pacific. Vancouver will fall out, and now you're chasing Vancouver and Winnipeg, who I still think, on paper, the Wild are the better team. So now, but you can't fall 12 points by up here. Now, if you could somehow figure out a way to sweep the Winnipeg Jets, which the Wild have done before, look at the records that I put since they become the Winnipeg Jets on the blog today. The Wild are 5-2-1 against them. They haven't lost here in regulation against them. If you could figure out a way to sweep them, now you're four back with three games in hand. Wild are pretty much in good shape. But now you fall, you lose both, and man, is the collars around the necks are going to tighten here. And now almost everything that you read in today's Star Tribune is irrelevant, because, you know, really, is Mike Yeo then really legitimately, absolutely, quote-unquote, safe, as Chuck Fletcher said? Is he really not going to trade for a goalie? Is he really, you know, at some point, you know, there could be some blind panic on the owner's part here, which changes everything Chuck Fletcher might think.
Right, absolutely. Let's go big picture. Hockey's fascinating because, you know, baseball, it's really a skill game. You know, yeah, you want to see people run the bases hard. You want to see them go after fly balls hard. But it's basically a skill game. Football, it's short bursts of energy. And if you don't play hard, you're going to get hurt. Basketball, there are places you can coast. There are times you can lay off. You can rest on defense. There are times you can rest in transition. Hockey's different.
Yeah.
And I go back to covering Jacques Lemaire for years. And he always said something along the lines of, I'm sure I won't quote him exactly accurately, but paraphrasing him, he'd always say, you cannot play this game a half step behind. It is an energy sport.
Yep.
And he would always study the body language of players, even between periods of a game, to see who had the energy to play well the next day. And if you're sick or you're tired, you just can't play this game.
Yeah. And you're right. I mean, and the other thing that you learn about watching hockey on a constant basis is puck support and being five-man units. And, you know, there are a couple guys on this team that have had terrible seasons that also, when you put them on a line, slow the line down. And, you know, if you can't trust the guy to your right, you know, you cannot play this sport. You know, this sport is all about putting the puck in positions where you could get it or get it up or get it out. And if all of a sudden somebody is not doing what they can, you can't trust that fact of a teammate doing his job. It just doesn't work. And so, you know, the Wild have to get everybody back on the same page here, regardless of the sickness excuse and the, you know, everything's Backstrom and Kepper's fault excuse. The team is in deep trouble here right now, and they've got to figure it out here. So, you know, the hope is that these 3 days of not being around each other actually remedied everything. I think that's easier said than done, and I think we'll see it tonight. I think it'll be interesting to see how this team comes out, because they haven't been on the ice in 3 days. You know, it's interesting. Mike Yeo had a quote today where he said, let me find it. He goes, first game back, the biggest challenge is finding your execution level, finding your timing, conditioning. I find that the guys are a little bit heavy, a little bit more winded. He might be talking about the sports writers after Christmas, but I think more than I think more than anything else, it's the details, the challenges of finding the details in the game. Well, this was the Wild before the break too.
Yeah.
they couldn't find the execution level of the details. So for them to expect that everything is going to magically reappear after not being around each other for 3 days, for some guys, you know, half the team going off to different spots. Darcy Kuemper left town, hasn't seen a puck in 3 days. It wasn't like he was playing overly great before. You know, to them to expect, tonight's going to be an interesting game. I mean, I just remember that game in Winnipeg December 27th last year. It was 4-3 after the first period. Mm-hmm. It was mind-boggling how sloppy both teams were. This is not an easy game for either team to play, so the Wild have to figure out a way here to overcome all this.
If you're the general manager or the coach of this team, what do you do, if anything, about Thomas Vanek?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I might have to buy him out after the year. I could say that because I don't think he's tradable. First of all, he's got a no trade. But second of all, I just don't think, you know, it's amazing that teams offered him 7-year deals, but I don't think he's tradable. So I don't know what you do. I mean, eventually you might have to scratch him. They've tried everything. And this is my concern when they signed him. This mm-hmm. is why I was throwing out red flag after red flag the yep. entire second half last year. Like, he just doesn't fit into what this team is. This team is built on speed. This team is built on defense. This team is built on work ethic. What are the three problems with him so far this year? I like him as a guy. I think he's, but it's unbelievable. You have to come to a game to watch him and isolate your eyes on him to see the lack of work ethic at time, and it's just disconcerting, and it really stood out when he was on a line with Zach Parise. So I don't know what they're going to do. It was a mistake I know he scored some big goals lately and he might get on a tear, and if you replay this in 3 months, I might look like the biggest idiot in the world, but I just think this was a mistake on the GM's part signing him regardless. I know that they felt like as long as we get him on a short-term deal, we'll be able to, what he does well is going to overcome what he doesn't. And, but I just don't, like I just said, when you have a guy, you just got to worry that some of the habits that he brings sometimes are contagious. And I do think that some of it's rubbing off on teammates. And, that's on Chuck. That's on Leopold. I don't think it's on the coach. I really don't. I the coach was given him. So the coach's job to get the best out of him. But let's put it this way. I'll bet my career that if he continues to play like this, if Mike Yeo is going to want to save his job, he's not going to wait till the last 7 games of Danny Heatley. How Danny Heatley wasn't scratched for until the last 7 games yep. of his career here in Minnesota? Mike's going to have to do that well ahead of time with Thomas Vanek.
Yeah. That's Michael Russo. I'm Jim Suhan. This is SuhanUnfiltered.com. As I said at the beginning of the podcast, we will eventually have a joint podcast that will have its own page on our network and everything else on the Alive and Social network. Right now, let's throw some Twitter questions at Mr. Russo. The first one from Carl Detlefson. Why does Granlund change from black to white tape mid-game?
You know what? I wish I don't know if it's the same person that asked me that last week, but I completely, because he got sick, I hadn't seen Granlund in a long time, and then it slipped my mind to even ask him. Okay. I don't know. Whoever that is, I have the worst memory in history. So whoever that is, email me at mrusso@StarTribune, and I will. One, either ask a trainer or I'll ask Granlund tomorrow in Winnipeg.
All right, and we'll have an answer on the next podcast if we remember. But I'm an airhead too. Another question from Brian Durheim. What type of D-man do you think Fletcher would ideally like to add?
Well, I know that they would love to add a big bomb from the point eventually, and they're hoping that Dumba turns into that guy. But, Keith Yandle is a lot of readers have asked me about. The Wild could probably get him right now, but he's a lefty, and I think they really want a right-handed bomb. That's been what they're trying to get for the last couple of years that they just don't have. They lack that, and everybody does, but a P.K. Subban, a Shea Weber, the way the Wild's power play is set up, you need a right-handed bomb.
Yeah.
You can't have Jason Pominville or Jared continue to fan on shots from that play when the whole point of that power play is to set up that shot. But right now, imminently, Chuck Fletcher needs to get a defenseman in here. I mean, it is. You cannot continue to have Stu Bickle and Justin Falk and these guys playing 6-7 minutes a night. It just cannot happen. I mean, Keith Ballard's injury, and it's not like he was playing great, but it's really now defeated the depth of this team. They obviously have no faith in John Blum because they just keep him in the minors. And Matt Dumba, they want – first of all, Matt Dumba, one of my colleagues from the Pioneer Press was just down in Iowa and told me how bad Matt Dumba was down there in the one game at least he saw. But, you know, they want Matt – they don't want to keep on bringing him up and down. They want him – you know, they might have to at some point. But they want him to play and play consistently and be molded by guys like Richard Park and John Torchetti. So, you know, I've got to think, and it might be a minor move, but I got to think that tonight at midnight when that roster freeze is lifted, that in the next day or two, I would hope that the Wild makes some sort of acquisition for a defenseman that can play regularly. I think one big reason, you look at the last five or six games, first of all, this is four games in a row that they've had a different third D pair. They've rotated that. And, you know, you look at the way that Brodin and Suter and Spurgeon and even Scandella have played the last little while, they've all taken turns for the worst here. And I think it has to do with the fact that even though Ballard might have been erratic, at least he was playing regular minutes. And Prosser's game has taken a turn here too. So, you know, I just think that they got to get somebody in here that can play a regular 12 to 14 minute game a night. And then you can take away some of the ice time from Brodin and Spurgeon and Scandella and Suter. So I think that of all the problems the Wild have right now, the goaltending, the lack of a big time defenseman, I really think they just got to make some sort of acquisition for some sort of D today. I joked with Shane Knighty this morning, who used to be the seventh D for the Wild. You know, now would be the perfect time for him to come out of retirement. He's a TV guy for the Winnipeg Jets, and I took a picture of him and put it on Twitter and said that I was trying to get him to come out of retirement.
Next Twitter question from Michael Russo, Star Tribune hockey writer. Gregory Daigle Jr. asks, Does Russo plan to stay in Minnesota long-term? He sure is an asset to the info-hungry Wild fan.
Yeah, I do. I have no plans on leaving. You're stuck with me.
Bryant H. asks, why do fans fall into the blame-the-coach trap, changes to coaching and season coaching mid-season fail far more often than they succeed?
Yeah, I mean, I just think that's just nature of sports. You would know as well as I do, right, Jim? I mean, you know, it's always the players that get credit when they win, and it's usually the coach you blame when they lose. The other issue with the Wild is that there really isn't a lot of stuff that Chuck Fletcher can do. You know, if you want to, you know, all the veterans that you might want to get rid of, all have either no trades or long-term deals that are probably unmovable. The guys that you can move are probably guys that are not going to change much in your locker room. I don't think on a 14-game sample size of the team playing poorly that you're just going to say, all right, we're trading Mikhail Granlin for something. That's not Chuck Fletcher's style by any stretch. So, you know, since the GM is kind of hamstrung here, the obvious next thing is kind of the coach. I just think that also fans are frustrated. They're, you know, even the players are exhausted of every year battling for eighth. And that's what's why there's so much negativity in this town right now, is that they were all sold by, you know, both the team and maybe the beat writers that these young kids were outstanding. And we still all forget that they are 21. I mean, in this sport, you know, unless you have a special Patrick Kane or Jonathan Toews or Sidney Crosby or Alex Ovechkin, it takes a while for these guys to become the player that you expect them to be. Usually, and the Wild are just a weird team. You have all these 21 and 22-year-olds, and you have all these 30-year-olds. There's nothing in between. And so eventually these 21-year-olds are going to become those 25-year-olds, and by then you hope they're at their peak and they're kind of finished products at that point where they can lead this team to greatness. The problem is that to do that, you got to wait 3 or 4 years. So everybody's just frustrated and impatient, and they're tired of the same thing, and I get it. So the other thing with this Wild team that's so frustrating from everybody's standpoint is that the extreme highs and the extreme lows. Again, I just had lunch here with Ryan Yock, and he's a Wild fan, and he was saying to me that, you know, this is the same thing every year. Mm-hmm. You know, they start off well, then they collapse. You know, it's just the same thing. And so, you know, eventually that's going to come down on Mike Yo, whether it's fair or not, and that's why everybody's kind of in the blame the coach mode. And I believe in Yo. I think he's a great coach. I get to talk to him more, you know, privately than really anybody out there. And I know that this guy can coach. You just hope that he continues to get, if this place is in danger of going dark in April, I mean, this is professional sports. He's in trouble. And so that's the interesting thing here. This is a huge couple weeks for this team.
Absolutely. Here's a question kind of out of left field. Randall EV your thoughts on the historical significance of Minnesota and Winnipeg playing on Boxing Day.
There's really no historical significance. That will be, though, the tradition. And the reason why is because in the NHL, you have the mandatory three-day break. So geographically, because the team is not allowed to leave their city until 7 a.m. of the morning of the game, the day of the 27th, the league tries to make sure that, like, say, the I'm sure if you look today, the Islanders are probably playing the Rangers or the Sabres. You know, here, Arizona is playing Anaheim. You know, Edmonton's playing Calgary. Devils playing the Rangers. Islanders, Buffalo, Detroit, Ottawa, their closest rival. Columbus, Boston, Dallas, St. Louis. So that's the thing. So they try to make it a very quick trip for the team that has to fly the morning of the game. So last year, the Wild flew to Winnipeg. Next year, the Wild will probably fly to Winnipeg. That would be my guess. Or Chicago. It's going to be. So it's not like a. This is not a Boxing Day. Let's put it this way. It's not the reason they're playing.
Right.
You know, it's a geographical reason. All right. Just happens to be Boxing Day.
Four more questions.
And trust me, I know I flew December 26th last year. This is funny. Chad and I, the Pioneer Press writer. So we fly. The team can't go until the 27th last year, mm-hmm. but we said, you know, why are we going to go the morning of the game? So we went up the night before to Winnipeg. So he and I decided to go to dinner. We're stupid Americans, right?
Yeah.
Especially Chad. No, I'm just kidding. So so Chad and I are in, like, minus 10 degree weather walking to this Italian restaurant that we heard about, okay, from the Philadelphia Flyers writers, coincidentally. So we're walking there, and we can't understand why every restaurant we go to is closed.
Yeah.
We're like, what is going on here? And then somebody, you know, it's Boxing Day, right? I'm like, oh, yeah. And I mean, honestly, Chad's like, at least I had, like, gloves and a scarf. Chad's, like, walking around in, like honestly, just probably a jacket. Pretty funny.
Stupid American.
Yeah.
All right. Four more quick Twitter questions, then we'll move on to other topics. What are the chances Dan Bylsma is coaching the Wild next year?
You know, obviously a lot of people have brought him up because he is the big name out there right now. And Bylsma is, I mean, you know, everybody also looks at it. Chuck Fletcher was the assistant GM in Pittsburgh. Bylsma was the head coach in Pittsburgh. Mike Yeo was actually his assistant. I'm trying to think of the best way to put this. I will just say this. You know, I'm trying to think of the best way that I could say this.
You're hedging.
Yeah, I know. He was the Olympic coach.
Mm-hmm.
The captain of the U.S. Olympic team was Parisi. The number one defenseman on the Olympic team was Ryan Suter. They failed miserably. You know, I think that's probably something that might keep him from being the head coach here.
Very interesting.
You know, I don't think I'm you know, revealing – you know, state secrets, you know, just read between the lines of some of the quotes. I just don't think that there was, when Parisi and Suter came back, there were some things said that I think that there was just probably some behind the scenes, not exactly overly enamored the way that the style of that team and the way the players ice time were deployed and things like that. And if that stuff is ever kind of conveyed to Chuck Fletcher, could be a reason. Remember, these guys have 11 more years each on their contracts.
Yeah.
I mean, if that is something that they don't respect, Bylsma, that could be something that keeps them from being the head coach of the Wild. I mean,
right.
That is, they are the two guys that are kind of decision makers. Whether when you sign two guys to 13-year deals, they're usually in on a lot of the meetings.
No question. Three more quickies. At what point will Wild goaltending problems be addressed?
It's got to be addressed. Yeah, but it's got to be addressed. I mean, regardless of the way that the team is playing right now, they've got to figure out this year, is Darcy Kuemper the future? And if not, they've got to address it long term because they have no – obviously, John Curry is just a guy in the minors that is no – you know, he's not ever going to play here on a regular basis. And Johan Gustafsson has just been terrible down there. I mean, you know, a lot of people wondered why he didn't play in Winnipeg on Boxing Day last year when Backstrom was getting shellacked. And it was because Gustafsson didn't freaking stop a puck at the morning skate. He couldn't even – I mean, it was unbelievable watching how bad he was. So, like, he just doesn't look like he's going to be the goalie that they had hoped. So they've – you know, they have a couple other guys that are in junior hockey right now. I think Belanger is one, and they have McCulloch still in the system, and there's a guy in Europe who's having a great year, a Finnish guy. You know, so maybe they turn out to be the guy way down the road, but this is way down the road, right?
Yeah.
So they might have to figure it out. I mean, you know, the guy that still intrigues me is Cam Ward. You know, I was down in Raleigh last weekend, actually, just for something else, and I went to that game against the game against the Rangers I watched, And Carolina beat him, and I thought he was outstanding. And you look at him, and he looks like he's a different goalie than he has been the last couple of years. He makes $6.3 million cap hit now. The Wild can afford that. He makes $6.3 next year. But, you know, and they could probably get him pretty cheap because I think Carolina's in sell mode. But, you know, I just don't, you know, is Cam Ward the goalie of the future at 30? You know, that's usually when goalies take a big-time collapse. So I don't know. I at some point, they're going to have to figure this out, though. You know, Mike Smith's another guy. He's just absolutely atrocious this year. The Wild had interest in him a couple years ago, but he re-signed in Arizona. That's when the Wild gave Backstrom that three-year deal. Actually, it was kind of when they found out that Smith was going to not go to free agency. But Smith has been awful. I mean, we're just down there, and, you know, Dave Tippett didn't even start him against the Wild because he's been so bad. I mean, I don't know. I wouldn't touch him right now.
That the last two questions were from Ryan Link and Steve Wilson. Two more Twitter questions, one from Jeremy Sather. Given the Wild plays a rival tonight, are they in need of a legitimate tough guy to keep teams in check?
Well, I mean, that's why Bickle's sort of in. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. There's no real tough guys in the NHL anymore. And I don't buy into the whole tough guy thing. You know, I also don't buy into, like, I got an email or a tweet the other day. It's like, the Wild have been manhandled in the last 20 games. And I'm like, I just don't see that. I don't buy it. And this is not...
I'm with you.
I mean, this game is about speed right now, and the reason why the Wild stink is they look slow. Mm-hmm. You know, I just don't know what adding – first of all, there's like four John Scotts in the league, and are you telling me that the Wild would be a better team with John Scott? No. I mean, give me a break.
No.
Last, and I don't mean to sound – I don't make that person to ask that question to, like, take – like, criticize. I don't want you to think I'm disrespecting you. I just – the whole enforcer thing, I just don't buy anymore. I think that – you know, I get that question a ton, and I just think that people that ask the question are just not watching today's game. You know, Chicago Blackhawks get by. Now, Chicago Blackhawks are a lot more talented than the Wild, but, you know, with superstars throughout their lineup. But, you know, there's a reason why there's no fighting in the playoffs, right?
Yep.
The if you want to ask me, are the Wild small enough or too small or too weak or things like that, that's a different story. I think the Wild are. I think there's a reason why they lose to the LA Kings and the St. Louis Blues every night and the Anaheim Ducks. I think that is an issue, but I don't think that you know, a legitimate tough guy is the answer.
Well, I think, and I said this during the playoffs last year, you need tough players. You don't need a guy who can't play hockey to drop the gloves and beat up another guy who can't play hockey at mid ice to prove anything.
Yeah,
it's silly. Last Twitter question, another one from Bryant H. What's the temperature of the locker room? Do the players take responsibility, or are they quietly looking for excuses?
You know, the temperature's not good. I don't think they're blaming Yo. A lot of people have asked me, has Yo lost the room? I don't buy that at all. I think that's an easy excuse for underperforming players. I do think, though, the quotes after the recent games, when you talk to Parisi Cook on the record, there's trust issues in the locker room right now. I don't know if that has to do with some of the players we mentioned and not them buying in, or what, but I think that comes with just losing, and once they win a couple games, everything will be back to normal. But I think that right now, you know, the temperature isn't good. There's a lack of confidence at a minimum, and they've just got to figure it out. I mean, they've got to. They're blowing their season right now.
Now, very important question from me, not from Twitter, from me. Why would you ever bash into Nick Schultz's Porsche?
Oh, my God. That's a good story.
Well, it's hope.
Yeah. It's funny. I told the Flyers writers this story the other day, and, you know, Schultz plays for the Flyers, and he's been their most consistent defenseman. And so Schultz after
good
the game,
good dude too. I really
like
him.
Yeah. So we're waiting to get in the Wild locker room after the game, and Schultz comes out and he sees me and he goes, and he just starts laughing. He goes, "You told the Flyers writers the Porsche story." This story will tell you what type of human being Nick Schultz is. About 2 or 3 years ago, Matt Cullen's last year here, he played his 1,000th game. I think it was in January, and it must have been right before the Wild's father-son trip to Philadelphia and Toronto, I think. So they had their team party to celebrate the 1,000th game at the downtowner after that game, and I went to Tom Reed's after the game, and I went to Tom Reed's. I hung out for about an hour, and I go out to the parking lot next to the Dunn Brothers there, and which is also the downtowner parking lot, and I'm backing out of my car, and crack, hit something. So I get out, I'm like, you know what. And I get out, and then I really had an oh-you-know-what moment. I look, and it's a black Porsche. And I'm looking at the front. I mean, it wasn't major damage, but it was a Porsche, and it was scratched. You know? So I'm looking up, and I immediately know it's a player's car, right? I mean, it's a black Porsche and the downtown parking lot when they're having their team party.
Yeah.
And the first thing I'm thinking of is, like, please don't be Devin Setoguchi's. Like, Setoguchi hates my guts, you know? Like,
you almost fought Devin Setoguchi.
I know, I did. That we'll tell that on another podcast. Okay. I almost, God, now we're, this podcast is turning into all my trade secrets. This is
awesome.
Like, yeah, I almost, Seto and I almost got into a brawl one night on the streets
of
Columbus.
And the great thing about the podcast is I will inadvertently bring up things that you've told me, like, off the record, and all of a sudden they're on the record.
Yeah, I know.
It's like the old Royce line.
Yeah.
It's too good to be off the record.
Yeah. This was an off-the-record story that I'm telling until now. So I'm like, please don't be Setoguchi. Please don't be Daryl Powell. Please don't be Brad Stelvitz. For some reason, a lot of guys hated me on that team. And all of a sudden, I look up, and Jared Spurgeon is walking out of the downtowner with his dad.
A guy you can take.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
So Spurgeon's like kind of tiptoeing toward me, and I'm like, and he sees that I hit this car, and he goes, and he looks at me and he goes, and I look at him and I go, whose car is it? And he goes, I think it is. And I remember thinking to myself, please say Nick Schultz or Matt Cullen.
Yep.
And then immediately, actually, the first thought is like, they wouldn't be driving a Porsche, either of them, right? And he goes, I think it's Schultz's. And like right when he said Schultz's, it's like all this stress left my body, okay? It was like, I don't know why. It's still a Porsche, you know? But Schultz was like, you know, Schultz is just an ally. Like, there's no nicer human being in the world than Nick Schultz,
right? He was my favorite guy.
Oh, he's just one of the best people that you can ever meet. And so Jared's like, I'll go get him. And I'm like, you know, and I remember Jared running across, 7th there. And I remember I'm like, Jared! And he's like, what? And I'm like, don't make a scene. You know, like he's running back into the team party. And I'm just
like, what Russo did.
Yeah, like I don't need him to, like, I don't need 50 players coming out, right? So all of a sudden I'm sitting there and I'm like looking at the damage and I'm like trying to, you know, it's like January. So I'm trying to like clean up the car a bit, like, you know, trying to like, you know, make it like it doesn't look as bad as it really is. And all of a sudden Schultze comes over and he looks at me. He just starts laughing. He goes, I thought he was kidding, you know? And then Schultze, he goes to me, he goes, just go home. And I'm like, no, I'm like, I'll pay whatever. I'm sorry. You know, here's the Star Tribune credit card. he's just.
Can you expense a Porsche?
I don't think you can. I think I'm just going to try to expense a Porsche.
I'm like telling him,
I'm like, I whatever it costs, I will pay. I'm so sorry. You know, he's like, Mike, go home. And I'm like, Nick, look at your car. And he's like, just go home. So I remember we go to like, you know, I don't know. I thought we were going on the father-son trip because Barry Spurgeon was there, Jared's dad, but maybe we were going to Denver. But I remember seeing him in Denver a couple days later, Schultz. And I'm like, how's the car? And he goes, you know, Schultz, right? He tries to make you feel better. He's like, it looked better in the morning. Like, you know? And I'm like, Nick, I am so sorry. I'll pay for it. He's like, Mike, don't worry about it. And so, like, I remember saying to him, I'm like, you have 2 weeks immunity. I said, you could do anything in a game 2 weeks short of losing the game for the Wild, and I will not write that you turned the puck over. And he was laughing, and it was like this big – everybody in the locker room at this point knew. So everybody was just hysterical because I gave Nick Schultz immunity from being ripped in the paper for 2 weeks.
How do I get – you know, I think that would be a great way to promote the podcast is give away Russo immunity.
Yeah.
Like, you know, to the third caller or something, or the third best tweet.
I won't rip you around.
You won't fire back on Twitter or something
I'll
like that.
I'll unblock you on
exactly.
Here we go. Any Minnesota Wild fan not listening to the Suhan Unfiltered.com podcast with Suhan and Russo Strib is cheating themselves. Must listen. Isn't that nice? Just retweeted that.
Awesome. Let's change gears here real quickly, and then we'll get into kind of the end of the podcast weird questions I ask. You know, being in Miami last weekend and seeing, like, maybe 2,000 or 3,000 people wanting to come out to a Dolphins game and watch the Vikings. And you covered the Panthers down there. Obviously, the Marlins don't draw very well unless they are winning the World Series as we speak. It's a weird sports market, isn't it?
Oh, it is, absolutely. In fact, I was, as you were saying this, I was going to go to NBA.com just to see what the Heat's record. Do they stink this year, the Heat, without Shaq? I know they beat them the other night.
I'm not really paying attention.
Yeah, let me look at this. Because the reason why I was going to say this is that they are weird. The year before Shaq got to Miami, they were curtaining off the upper bowl at Miami Heat games.
Yeah.
And that's the market. The local TV stations have to buy out all the tickets for the Dolphin games to make sure that they don't get blacked out down in South Florida. Yeah, the Heat are about 7th in the East, so I give them about a month before they have to curtain off the top. That's the market.
Yeah.
When the Panthers were unbelievable and they had Pavel Bure sold out every game. When the And I mean that's the way fans are, but especially down in South Florida, the Marlins, you know, that year, the years they won the World Series, that they absolutely sold out Joe Robbie Stadium or whatever it's called now, Pro Player, Sun Life. You know, they were getting 10,000 a game during the regular season. That's the market down there. You know, there's just so many things to do for your entertainment dollar in South Florida. It's so hard to get to any of these places because it's such a massive place.
Yes.
You know, the traffic to, I mean, trust me, I lived in Boca Raton and used to have to drive to Miami Arena. You know, that was terrible. The Panthers used to have their Gold Coast Arena in Pompano, that used to be where they'd have their morning skates, and then they would get the players' hotel rooms at the Intercontinental so they wouldn't have to drive down during rush hour. So after the morning skate at Pompano, they would go down and stay at this hotel, get their afternoon naps in, and then go and play it when they were at Miami Arena, and then they moved up to Broward County. But it is. It's just a terrible – it's not a terrible sports market. There's just so many things to do in South Florida, and if you don't win, you're going to lose them quickly. And then, like, you know, you mentioned the Panthers. They haven't won in 17 years. I mean, you know, Ryan Yock here wasn't alive, I don't think, when the Panthers went to the Stanley Cup Finals. When were you born?
Okay, yeah, I was going to question whether he was alive during the Wild's last playoff last year.
So he was an infant. That's the last time – the last time that the Panthers won a playoff round. So that was the year. So just imagine an 18-year-old down in South Florida right now, their entire life they have never seen the Panthers be good. That's why they have – it's not the market. It drives me absolutely freaking crazy when people rip South Florida that they can't support a hockey team. They can't support a hockey team because a high school senior has not seen the Panthers win. That's why. And so it's not that people love to rip on South Florida hockey fans. Trust me, I have seen it. They used to sell out Miami Arena, and they were the most passionate fans in the world. When they had Pavel Bure, freaking 20,000 people used to come to that arena every single freaking night. And they have not been given any reason to come to that arena. And when you live in South Florida, can stare at the sun and go to the beach and go hang around South Beach instead of going to watch the Panthers lose, you're going to choose that. That's why.
By the way, you were retweeting some compliments of the show. Let me just kind of let us know. Bring our hat sizes down a little bit. Anthony LaPanta just texted me, and the text reads as such: blah 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 blah. I read that verbatim. That was Anthony LaPanta's text to me and you.
Yeah.
So just, you know, not everybody loves us, Mike.
I know.
All right.
I'll tell you what, though. Anthony, he is one of the great guys. Honestly, I can't even convey to you, like, how, like, I didn't know him, basically, before he got the Panthers play-by-play guy. Wild's play-by-play job. He's as good of a dude as there is. I mean, he is just awesome.
And he does a great job. What I love about Anthony is
he's polished, professional.
What I love about Anthony is he does his own homework. Yeah, and I saw that back when he was FSN's kind of general guy.
He's basically my statistician.
Yeah,
he does all these graphics for FSN.
Yep.
And sends them to me to help my writing.
Yeah, I just love it because let's be honest, the cliche about kind of the empty-headed TV guy.
Yeah,
it's not 100% true, but it's true too often. You know, it's just the obvious. They try to give you the final score and slap you on the back.
Look at the bench right now.
Anthony does his homework.
Look at the bench right now.
Who's down there?
That's Zach Parise.
This is Zach.
He's just staring at the rink right now.
I guess it wouldn't be right to yell at him right now, huh?
No, we'll
let him concentrate. And to paint the picture, we are in the XL Energy press box. The arena is completely empty except for us knuckleheads up in the press box. Look down at the bench, and there is an equipment guy in the visiting bench setting things up. In the home bench, Zach Parise wearing a black hoodie, holding a stick, staring at the ice. I think the man is a little committed.
Yeah, he does this. This is his routine every game. He goes out there for about 10 minutes and looks at every inch of the rink. And just does mental exercises. He plays shifts in his head. I mean, it's just really neat.
That's pretty fascinating.
Yeah. And in a little bit, Nino's the only other guy on the team that does this. He will climb into the stands and go sit alone in the stands and do the same thing.
I remember I did a piece on that, on him doing that during the playoffs last year.
But, I mean, I kind of like watching this because, I mean, look at him. He is absolutely playing shifts in his head right now. In that, like, he's looking at that right corner. And I mean, it's just, you know, there's so much that goes into these players. It's unbelievable. You know, I mean, one of the cool parts of this job, too, is that we get to go down into the bowels of the locker room, bowels of the arena before the game, and it's unbelievable the stretches these guys do before games, you know, with you know, rubber bands, and all, it's really...
And all the hacky sack being played.
Yeah, it's unbelievable. There's Marty Manley, one of the security guards. And what Marty does now is he's checking, you see that, what he's doing is that's a railing right there, and that railing has to be unlocked, mm-hmm. because that's where the, as you saw, you see right now he's checking it.
Yep.
What he does is that the security guy, that right behind there is where the trauma doctor from Region sits during all games. And so when there's all of a sudden a major you know, emergency like they had with Ballard, the security guard jobs is to lift that thing up so he can fly down and get to the ice immediately.
Wow.
Yep.
That's pretty cool stuff. You know what? I had a bunch of other little questions I was going to ask you. I'm going to save those for the next time.
Okay.
I think we're going to try to figure out a way to get together on Friday to do our next podcast. Listeners can find this podcast, previous podcasts with Michael, previous podcasts that I've done with all kinds of other cool people around town at SuhanUnfiltered.com. Again, Michael and I will eventually do our own joint podcast. It will have its own page. Right now, go to SuhanUnfiltered.com to find all that stuff. We do appreciate you listening. Anything else? Let's see. Anything else to plug? I guess Friday, Wednesday night, 5 o'clock, I'll be at the local with a guest to do a live podcast on New Year's Eve. The following Wednesday, I will be here at 5 o'clock. Michael, anything else you want to say?
No, I just got the same.
You got the blah, 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 blah. Yeah. Yeah, that might be a text.
Hey, look, my mom.
Awesome. Well, we can't get your mom. We might as well hang it up, right?
Yeah, yeah. I love listening to you. And blah, blah, blah.
Hey, I've got two mothers in a row. Mark Craig's mother was listening last night.
Nice. I hope my mom tuned in after I started cursing at the beginning.
I hope your mom tuned in.
Actually, my mother has known me for 40 years. She knows that I swear.
Well, I just hope your mom, and I'm just going to guess your mom just dropped off, so she won't mind me bringing up that Anthony Weiner is Texas.
Yeah, right. You know what?
Mom, it's okay, right?
Trust me, my mom watches every Wild game, and trust me, she's got a vulgar mouth, too. I'll get text with her.
What the fuck is going on here?
It is unbelievable.
Mother, you don't hear that on local radio. We stood outside the Chinese restaurant. Hey, listen, thank you for all the questions. Thank you for listening. And follow us on Twitter to keep up with our podcast schedule at Russo Strip. Right?
Yeah, Russo Strip.
Russo at Russo Strip and at Suhan Strip to find out how the next podcast. Again, for Zach Parisi, who just left the bench. Michael Russo, for Evan Davis, for Stacey Gill, who came to be our audience today, for Ryan Yaxi, whose mother I knew when she used to work for, Victory Sports? K-Fan, that's right. Andrea used to work for K-Fan, so I knew Andrea back in the day.
She worked everywhere. You're 11?
Yeah.
She's the Minnesota United, one of the Veeps, business operator.
Oh, wow.
Business development.
Awesome. That sounds important.
Yeah. She does a great job getting us out there during the summer.
I'll have to go.
It's very smart. Her and the PR guy, Eric Durkin, they would probably love, you know, more publicity from the local press. But they've done a smart thing. They basically invite us out there to games to watch. They're this great, awesome product, Minnesota United. Then we go and tweet about it, so at least they're getting the social media. I honestly had a blast. I went out there probably 3 or 4 games this summer.
Well, Ryan, tell me that we will do a podcast up there.
Yeah, absolutely. I would absolutely.
We'll have to. Cool.
We'll have Jamie Watson, who's one of their players. Absolutely unbelievable media guy. We'll have him as a guest.
Perfect.
Great dude.
Any last thoughts, Michael?
No, I think I've talked too much.
You know, you really didn't give me many openings. I will say that. This is the easiest job I've ever had in my life.
But don't you agree that the coffee is what allows me to be able to, like, I could just turn it on like that because I've had, like, you know, I've got caffeine just inching through my brain right now.
The way I look at it is drinking coffee keeps you, you know, you've heard of the gateway drug? Coffee is the roadblock drug.
Right.
Because you have coffee, you don't have to use anything stronger.
Yeah.
That's my view.
That's exactly right.
That's it for SuhanUnfiltered.com. Thanks for listening.